Welcome. Good morning. Welcome to the official social media marketing talk show, a Social Media Examiner production. I'm Mike Stelzner. I'm joined today by Kim Reynolds. Eric Fisher is in the control room. Jeff C is handling simulcast. Hello to everyone on Facebook, to everyone on Periscope, and to everyone on YouTube. If you want to join the action, be sure to come on over to Crowdcast. This is the show where marketers and entrepreneurs discover what just happened this week. What's the latest news? We literally prepare this show about 24 hours in advance. We bring on the experts. We talk about what's actually happening in the state of social media, literally right now. And anything can happen. Technical challenges can happen. Sometimes guests aren't able to technically get on, but we roll with the punches because the show must go on. This show is brought to you by the Social Media Marketing Society. It's only going to be open for a couple of more weeks. It is Social Media Examiner's membership community. And it's where we bring live training to you 3 times a month and where you can keep up in a more deep way. And you can find the details at socialmediasociety.info. All right. So on today's show, we're going to talk about a bunch of stuff. We're going to talk about Facebook news feed changes in the first segment. I'll be talking about that. Then if we can get Carlos Gill technically on the line, we'll get into some Snapchat updates. We're going to talk about some brand new discoveries that we found here at Social Media Examiner about Facebook groups and tons of other breaking news. All right, a couple things. Check our weekly show calendar or get us on your calendar by visiting socialmediaexaminer.com/live show and do us a favor and share this show. All right, over to segment number one. Kim, if you could go ahead and pull up the screen cast specifically related to actually, segment number two about Facebook cracking down on some stuff with the newsfeed. I'm going to go ahead and bring that up on the screen here. Here we go. No, Kim, this is not the right one. I don't know if you have a screen share on this one. Do you not have a screen share on this one?
Let me check.
Okay. All right. Well, let's just assume there's no screen share on this one. So here's the deal. Facebook, I'm going to go ahead and just minimize that and tell me if you actually do have a screen share on that one. If you do, just pop it up there and tell me. So Facebook came out with some news on 2 days ago on May the 10th. And here's the deal. Again, they're tweaking the news feed algorithm. Facebook always makes adjustments, specifically when they feel like people are gaming the system. When they feel like marketers are doing things that are questionable, Facebook often changes the algorithm. They don't often publicly tell you about all their changes, but this is one that they have been very forthright about. And we have a link to this that we'll eventually get into the notes here. But here's the deal. You're going to see in your newsfeed a lot less low quality, what I'm going to call crap posts. Okay. So here's the deal. Here's what Facebook specifically said. Hundreds of thousands of web pages Facebook analyzed hundreds of thousands of web pages and identified the ones that are of little substantive content. Okay. Meaning the ones that don't have any value at all are the ones that Facebook is saying that. And here's how we know that they don't have any value. First of all, they have disruptive, shocking, or malicious ads on their website. And also, anybody who runs an ad that sends people to a page that has little substance on the website, disruptive, shocking, or malicious ads on the website, you're going to get less exposure with your paid ads. You're going to get less exposure with your posts. Now, the first thing that comes to mind, and I said this in the pre-meeting yesterday, Kim, is I said BuzzFeed is dead, right? Mm-hmm. Because if you think about it, what does BuzzFeed do? They create these posts that have little substance to it. Like, right, you're not going to believe what the bear did after the 2-minute mark, that kind of thing. You know, we've been talking about this for a long time, but they're taking it to the next level. They're not just going to reduce the likelihood that you will ever see this kind of a post. They're also reducing the likelihood that any ads to any of these kind of posts will ever work for you anymore. In addition, they're also looking at the content that surrounds the content on your web page. So if you create a page and then you surround it with ads that are meant to be misleading or shocking or malicious, They now are watching that. So what the algorithm did is artificial intelligence is it went over hundreds of thousands of pages and it said these kinds of content and these kinds of ads were going to push lower into the newsfeed. So that's the deal. Is it says the goal is to feature fewer misleading posts and more informative posts in the newsfeed. And the exciting thing about this is the following sentence that they said. Publishers that do not have this type of low quality landing page experience may see a small increase in traffic. So they're going to reward those of us that, you know, a slight increase, we'll take any increase considering how low things are right now. You know, we just had our social team meeting and we said it can't get much worse. So you're going to actually see an increase if you don't play this game. I personally do not believe this affects most of the people that are watching this video because I think most of us are marketers and are not participating in sly, shifty, manipulative tactics. These changes are gradually rolling out over the next couple of months. So that's all I've got to say on that. And with that, I am super excited to have Mr. Carlos Gill here on the call. And Kim, let's go ahead and get the right screenshot up on here.
What's going on, guys?
Carlos, how you doing, my man?
I'm great. Ready to talk about Snapchat.
So let's start with the elephant in the room, okay? There's two things we want to talk about with Snapchat. We want to talk about all these cool new features, but we want to talk about also the daily users and the growth and stuff. So let's start with that, Carlos. Talk about what you know they released with their quarterly earnings and their numbers and growth, and give me a little bit of the data and what you're assessing.
Absolutely. So Snap just had its first quarterly earnings since going public, and they announced that they have 166 million daily active users, which is really surprising. For the longest time, for well over a year, they were touting that they had 150 million daily active users. Now, Instagram, as we know, Snapchat's competitor, just came out on the scene before that and said that they have over 200 million daily active users. So Snapchat is not growing at the rate that I think Snapchat believed that they would grow at. And I think us as consumers and even marketers are pretty disappointed. My perspective on this is that Snapchat needs to grow up as a company and start appealing more to the masses, stop appealing less to Generation Z and to younger millennials, and start appealing more to the adults. At the end of the day, if you want to bring in the big brands and the marketers and the advertisers that bring money to help drive your revenue, you're going to have to go ahead and grow. Otherwise, unfortunately, you're going to fall on the fate of Twitter.
Yeah. And this is only, they were at 158, let's see here, according to TechCrunch, Snapchat hit 166 million daily active users at a growth rate of 5% compared to 158 million in the prior quarter. And that's not super big growth for a venture, you know, for a brand new stock that's on the public market. And as a matter of fact, it hit an all-time low today. And it got down to near IPO levels. Now, Evan Spiegel, is he the CEO or the founder or both?
He's a co-founder and CEO.
He keeps insisting, according to ABC News, that this is not a social network, but a camera company. And you need to look at us as a camera company. What's your reaction to that?
And by the way, I think the right screen is on the screen. Yeah, I think they can spin it any way that they want to spin it. At the end of the day, us consumers, I think, really dictate how Snapchat is viewed. And I think if you ask any person out there, they're going to tell you this is a social network. It's not a camera company. From the standpoint of saying that they're a camera company, I think what it does is it deflects the pressure off of them from having to necessarily compete head on with Facebook and Instagram, which, as we know, is one and the same since Facebook owns Instagram. But I think at the end of the day, Mike and Kim, anyone you ask out there, they're going to tell you Snapchat is a social network, which in fact is what it is. It's a social network and messaging app.
Kim, can you get the right screenshot up on the screen, please?
We don't have a screenshot.
Now, in terms of actual with a candy cane emoji, so it looks like they're taking a little page out of Instagram with being able to draw with emojis, and they're taking a page out of what was Vine from having that Vine-like functionality. Now, the biggest enhancement, or the biggest change, is Snapchat now has limitless snaps, which...
All right, hold on a second, Carlos. Kim, can you plus up that image at the top? I want to take a closer look at what's actually going on here. So what kind of explain, Carlos, what the heck we're looking at right here, because I think it might deserve some explanation. You mentioned a couple of things, but maybe dig in on what we're seeing here.
Yeah. So what you're looking at there is the ability to draw with emojis. So instead of drawing with a pointer or cursor that would be a pencil or a marker, you can select various emojis and you can draw with that, or you can essentially type things out with an emoji. So what you actually see there is a combination of using Bitmojis built in, as well as those stars, and I believe it's fire that you see. Those are actual emojis that are being used to draw. So as we know, you know, it's no secret that Snapchat is a platform in which you see creators like Sean Ayala and others that have really been able to tap into from a creative standpoint, along with their storytelling. So with this latest feature here, I think you're going to start seeing a lot more creativity coming out from the influencer and that community.
Cool. So what you were going to say about the limitless snaps, what is that exactly?
Yeah. So limitless snaps are the ability to send a Snapchat with no time limit. So previously, your longest snap that you'd be able to send is as long as 10 seconds or as short as 1 second, which is a snap. And that's from a competitive advantage standpoint, which really made Snapchat stand out. Now you can send a snap to someone and it will be there forever. So there'll be no time limit.
Okay, but that's only when you're sending a private snap to somebody, right? Not when you're posting it to your, whatever you call it, story or timeline.
So I've actually played around with this where I've posted content, and this is for you know, photo content. So I've actually posted a photo to my story and it will just stay there. And the only way to move on from that photo to the next is someone has to actually tap through. Unlike before, where if I set, for example, a time limit of, let's say, 3 seconds, after those 3 seconds, it would move on to the next part of my story.
Well, what's your thoughts on that? Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
I'd say this is a good thing from the standpoint of it gives content creators, and when I say content creators, I'm referring more so to brands. It gives them a little bit more flexibility with creating content that's going to stick around longer. I think in the bigger picture, it takes away from what has made Snapchat, Snapchat. Hmm.
Okay, looping videos. Talk about that. Oh, by the way, with this screenshot we're looking at, is this the ability to remove the limit? Is that kind of what we're looking at right here?
Yeah, it is. I'm reading here Eileen Smith saying, sounds boring. People will be posting their logos. Yeah, you know, going back to what I was saying before, it definitely takes away from the curb appeal of what historically has made Snapchat stand out as its own unique platform.
Cool. And looping videos, talk to us about that.
Yeah, so looping videos are essentially Vines. So if you're familiar with Vine from a couple of years ago, those 6-second videos that would just kind of keep replaying over and over, essentially that's what a looping video is. So you can create a short video and you can add it to your story, or you can send it to a friend, and that video will continue to play over and over again until you tap to the next part of the story.
Awesome. Kim, let's scroll down to the magic eraser and if possible, hit play on that little video. You may have to fix the volume, but maybe Carlos can like annotate what we're seeing here as we're watching this magic eraser thing.
Yeah, so what you're seeing here with the magic eraser is the ability to really remove objects from your snaps, as you see there on the screen. So let's say you take a photo of someone and you want to erase someone from the background, or you want to go ahead and take an object out of the photo, you have this eraser.
Like the ball is being cut right out of it, isn't it?
Yeah, so the ball is being cut, and then what Snapchat does is it automatically finds another part of the photo, and it automatically Photoshops it into the scene. Yeah.
That's the reason to use Snapchat, even if you're an Instagram person, because you can do stuff on here to make your pictures cool and then download it to your camera.
It definitely gives you some versatility. I was actually having fun with this the other day in San Francisco, where I was taking pictures of buildings, and I was erasing buildings out of the skyline. And wow, it's really cool how Snapchat, I was about to say Instagram, how Snapchat goes ahead and it takes like a picture of the blue sky, and then it crops it over where the building previously was.
So of all these features, Carlos, what are you most excited about?
I actually like the looping video feature. I was a big Vine fan. I had over 400 videos on Vine back in the day. So I'm actually really excited to see that functionality back now within Snapchat, which is no secret, my favorite social network and where I spend a lot of time. But I tell you also, you know, I really like Boomerang within Instagram. So I really like the fact that now there is this looping video feature, which just, it makes content creation fun. I think ultimately that's what keeps people coming back, is the fun aspect of the platform. Also, with that being said, if you remember back to Vine, for those of you that were on there, I personally would spend hours literally laying in bed watching Vine content. So I look forward to seeing what people do with this looping video feature, and hopefully it's a way to keep people much more engaged on Snapchat, which, as we know, would be really good for their revenue at this point.
I think that if we think strategically about what Snapchat has been doing wrong, they've not been iterating their features fast enough. So they just released four features at once. If they were smart, they would have released one feature every couple of days, which would have kept them in the news the moment they went public. Instead, they released almost no news, right? And then they came out with four kind of as at once. Mm-hmm. And I think what we see with Facebook is nearly every week there's new things with Facebook. And I think that keeps the users, especially the creators, it keeps them excited about wanting to keep experimenting with the tools and not give up on it because they see the path of innovation that's happening. I'm just wondering, you know, I keep going back to Evan Spiegel saying, we're a camera company, we're a camera company. I keep in my brain saying, well, prove it to me then, you know, where is your killer virtual reality or augmented reality stuff? And where is, I mean, they did come out with a cool feature a couple of weeks ago with the ability to like create a rainbow and have it augmentedly be stuck to a thing. I thought that was a really cool feature.
Agreed.
But I don't know. I'm beginning to wonder whether or not, if I was the target audience for Snapchat and I've got Instagram over here continuously innovating, I mean, you know, the millennials and the younger Gen Y and all that, Gen Z or whatever they call them, I'm sure they're conflicted. Which one do I go to? I seem to see more exciting things coming from Instagram. I don't know. Maybe that's why they're not seeing any growth. What's your thoughts?
Well, something that you said that stood out was that when Facebook comes out with an announcement that they get the creator community really engaged and charged up, YouTube does the same thing. Historically, we really haven't seen Snapchat embrace creators. We saw this happen when Spectacles came out. We've seen this happen, you know, even as, you know, folks like myself are out there doing speaking engagements at events like Social Media Marketing World. They're not really embracing the creator community like we've seen Facebook and YouTube do. I think ultimately that's going to be a demise for Snapchat. You have to embrace the people that are creating the content on your platform and keeping the masses coming back. If you fail to do that, then you failed as a company. Without user growth, you're going to fail as a company and you're not going to be able to drive advertising revenue. And that's just, you know, basic economics 101. I think you're right. Instagram continues to be innovative. Instagram has taken, from my perspective, all the best features from Snap and Facebook, and they've kind of merged it into one.
Like you've got, but they've added features like a live component, which there is not.
Yeah, on Snapchat, right? You've got the live video. You have the filters. You know, you once again get like the best of the best within Instagram. Now, I want to point this out because I read this recently, and I had to go back just to make sure before I came on here that I quoted the right statistic. I recently read that over 80% of Instagram users are based outside the U.S. Really? I'm not sure if you knew that. I found that statistic fascinating.
Well, with 700 million people, I guess that makes sense. I mean, you think about it, right? I mean, there's only so many people in America that are on Instagram. But yeah, you're right. It's global. I get it. What were you going to say about that, though?
No, what I was going to say is, you know, obviously you're going to have people sitting back and they're going to be thinking, well, should I be on Instagram or should I be on Snapchat? This is like the question that gets asked of me all the time. And my answer is, historically, you should go where you have reach. So if you already have reach on Instagram, keep creating content on Instagram. Nothing changes. However, taking into account statistics, if Snapchat is a platform that's predominantly used by U.S. and Canadian millennials, then that should say something. That's probably where you should be spending time to engage that audience. Otherwise, go all in on Instagram if you already have the reach there. But taking into account that statistic of 80% of their users reside outside the U.S., for me, that was fascinating because it kind of creates a little bit of compare and contrast in terms of one platform versus the other and where the people are.
Carlos, last week, we talked about how Snapchat is coming out with essentially content, traditional television content being published in short form on Snapchat. What's your assessment on that? Do you feel like that will work? Do you feel like that'll keep people on Snapchat?
I can tell you, you know, the Discover section for me has become my go-to for where I used to consume traditional TV content. I use this as an example all the time. You can sit through and watch ESPN SportsCenter and spend 30 minutes of your day watching SportsCenter, or you can spend 3 minutes consuming the same content in micro form on Snapchat. I think that's ultimately where it's headed. I think we're already seeing not only on Snapchat, but we're seeing, you know, content popping up on YouTube and Facebook that's very much in short form that, you know, let's face it, this is becoming the new TV nowadays. So I think if Snapchat continues to go down that path where they're taking more of the traditional TV media content and putting it in micro form on the device, on the mobile device within Snapchat, what you're going to do is you're going to get a lot more people sticking around as opposed to going in, seeing what their friends are posting that day or snapping and then moving on to Facebook or the next platform.
Well, since it is Mother's Day, the quote, necessity is a mother of invention came to mind. And I think that if there's ever a time that Snapchat needs to innovate, it's right now, because they need to prove to their investors, which invested billions of dollars in that company, that this is an investment worth holding on to. So I anticipate we're going to see in the next 90 days some big innovation coming from Snapchat. The bigger question is whether Facebook beats them to the punch or not. So exciting times. For those that are trying to reach the audience that is on Snapchat, it is not a small audience. Let's have some perspective. This is not that much smaller than Pinterest, to give you some perspective. Mm-hmm. Which I think has 225 to 250 million users. So this is still, you know, worth pursuit if your audience is there.
And it's still early. You know, I was at Starbucks this morning getting some coffee. And when I was checking out Starbucks, there was a Snapchat code, Snap code, scan this to unlock an exclusive filter, which I thought was really cool, where I, for 1 hour, I could use this exclusive Snapchat filter. So by no means, you know, am I saying this isn't a platform where you should be spending your time? You know, I want to go ahead and put that in perspective. If you have reach already on Instagram, go all in. Use Instagram. But use Snapchat and think about it of how you're going to engage a different audience using the tool set on Snapchat that you don't have on Instagram. Mike, I wanted to ask you, in terms of talking about functionality on Snapchat, so in terms of like innovation within the next, let's say, 90 to 100 days, do you feel that live video is going to be what would put Snapchat up there on par with, say, Instagram?
No, I don't. I think the live video community wants to have live video on Snapchat, but I don't really have the answer. I think Snapchat has to figure out a way to draw an older community to them if they want to grow. And those are people over the age of 30, you know, and why would they use Snapchat when they already have all these other innovative, powerful apps that a lot of their friends are on? So they need to come out with something different that would incentivize someone to go over and try it, or incentivize someone to make room on their app, on their phone, for yet another app, you know? But in the beginning, they had that innovation, which is why people like me were there and found it innovating, because it was very fun and completely unique and different. So I don't think they're dead. They're not going to die. As a matter of fact, I bought a couple hundred shares this morning because it's cheap, and I'm just going to hold on to it because I think that there might be some virtual reality or augmented reality play that they're going to come out with. And I think that's what's going to take them to the next level, not live video. Carlos, listen, man, thank you so much for coming on. Tell everybody where they can discover more about you and all the cool stuff you've got going on.
Yeah, absolutely. You can visit my website, carlosgill.biz. From there, you can connect with me on all the different social networks, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat. And thank you so much, Mike and Kim, for having me on.
Thanks,
Carlos. My pleasure. Thank you so much.
All right, guys. Take care.
Bye. All right. Jen Ballard, if you're watching this, can you bring me something to drink? I am actually beginning to lose my voice. All right, we're going to move to the next segment here. And if we could get that screen share up there on the Facebook hidden functionality, I just want to real quickly let you guys know that this show is brought to you by the Social Media Marketing Society. And the society will be closing in a couple of weeks. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, we have a $300 off sale. Is that right, Kim? That ends today. So yeah, yes, that's it, $300 off. So for as little as $50 a month or $397 a year, you can get an entire year of professional development three times a month. We bring you experts who teach you in depth 90-minute online workshops into the latest stuff. Our news team, our marketing team, our social team meets, and we prepare the curriculum every month for where we see the world is going. So for example, literally next week, we have Molly Pittman from Digital Marketer coming on to talk about Facebook Messenger and bots. And thank you so much. I got the soda. And you know, that's the kind of stuff that we do. And we also have office hours where we bring staff from Social Media Examiner in, and you guys get to ask us privately, whatever burning questions you have. We have a private Facebook group. We've got just tons of stuff. It's a super value for as little as $50 a month or $397 a year. You're going to get ongoing professional development that could take you to the next level. Sale ends today. socialmediasociety.info. All right. With that, let's move to the next thing. Okay. Now this next thing, I'm going to go ahead and zoom the screen up to you guys for you guys to see this. Now, I don't know if you guys have Facebook pages, but you probably have clients that have Facebook pages, or you've been thinking about doing a Facebook page. And we discovered some really cool functionality that that a lot of us had never seen before. And I even posted this on my personal profile, and most of my friends who have big Facebook groups did not know that this functionality was here. And I will tell you that what I'm about to tell you is stuff that has been around for a while, but most people don't know about it. So this is kind of a, hey, we discovered something we never knew was always there. And it's my hope that you guys will also find this kind of cool. So if you go ahead on your mobile app or on the desktop, you go into your group. And typically when you go into a group and you are the admin or whatever of the group, there's a couple of functions that are across the top. And Kim, maybe you can go look up what those functions are real quick just by going into one of our groups. But then there's a dot, dot, dot on the mobile app. And when you click on the dot, 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 check out all the cool stuff that pops up. And this is exclusively for groups, okay? So here we go. We're showing you our private group right now for the Social Media Marketing Society, which now has almost 2,000 members inside of it. And when you click on the dot, 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 what pops up is start a live video, which most of you probably already know that you can go live into a group from the mobile app. But one of the cool features that we didn't realize was there was create a poll. So did you know that you can simply create a poll inside of your group by clicking on that button? Another thing that I thought was really cool is check this out, create a group event. So let's say that you are going to be going to have, for your group, you're gonna have a meetup or you're gonna have an online event. You can actually create a group event, which is an event that lives with inside of a group. And then you can encourage people to RSVP and keep it totally private within the group. I didn't know that. You can create a photo album. So for example, someone in the room here is saying, hey, all of us were at Social Media Marketing World, if there was a Social Media Marketing, oh, actually no, there are Social Media Marketing Society members that were at Social Media Marketing World. Someone is suggesting create a photo album inside of this special group just for those people. And we could do that. Sell something. Whoa, look at that. You can actually sell something right within your group. Now, that's the one that I'm most excited about. I don't even know how that works. I think that allows you to pop open an ad or something like that. Have you ever heard of that one before?
No, that's new to me, but I think that's really cool, especially, there's a lot of like mom groups and stuff that I belong to, and you can sell, I'm sure, all sorts of things. And the great thing is you're selling to somebody, if you're in the same group, I'm assuming that you know and or trust them. So that just adds another layer of functionality that.
Okay. So I'm looking at my, I'm looking at our staff group for Social Media Examiner, and here's what mm-hmm. I see write something, and then I see my little camera, right? That's what, and then you see three dots, and that's, the three dots are when you can pop up the exact menu that you see right here.
Right.
I'm clicking right now on sell something.
Mm-hmm.
And here's what it says. It says, what are you selling? What's the price? And then it says your city and then your description. And then you can add the post. And when you click on the city, so basically, you know what this sounds like to me? This sounds like the ability to actually sell physical products inside your group.
Yeah.
So, last week, Eric Fisher came on and he talked about the marketplace.
Marketplace.
So this is a private marketplace feature just mm-hmm. for a private group. How cool right. is that?
It's very cool. It's like your own little private Craigslist.
So if you happen to have a group that, let's say is interested in home decor and you're in Los Angeles and you have a bunch of people that want to get rid of a couch or something like that, you can actually sell right within that group.
Oh,
that's really cool.
Did you see that you can also add a photo or video?
I didn't even recognize that, no.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
So there's there you have it. Some people are saying, interesting, right? And hopefully your synapses are firing here and you're beginning to understand that there is some cool functionality that's inside of groups that maybe was hidden. As a matter of fact, I know it was hidden, you know, and I think we had just conveniently forgotten that some of these things were around. The sell something is definitely one that I don't recall ever, you know, hearing from before. So Kim, if you want to go ahead and go to the next screen, you can go ahead and go to the next news item.
Sure. Okay. So Facebook is rolling out a new Twitter-like feature called Latest Conversations in Search Results. And so if you're doing a search for a topic that's very popular and it's a timely topic, it will appear in its own section in search. And the thing that's interesting and new about this is it's going to give you a running live update of this topic. And you're going to see comments, as long as they're public comments, you're going to see public comments from people outside of your social circle. And it's going to be, and I don't know if this is a pro or con, but it's going to be in their native language. And it'll have a little translate button if it's in a language other than your own. But at the top, there's going to be a counter with, if you see the counter up here, the counter with how many people are talking about this. And right now, some other things. Right now, it's only on mobile.
Yeah, we tried it yesterday in our news team.
Right.
And there, you guys can try it right now. Like everybody, pop open your Facebook, your phone, and type in North Korea. Now, when you first type in North Korea, you have to. At least we found that you had to scroll quite a bit to get to the latest conversations. Wasn't that your experience?
Well, the first section for me that comes up is news, and then the second section that comes up is latest conversations. Now, today there's far fewer people talking about North Korea than yesterday.
But it shows you the number of people that are talking about it.
Yes.
And I think those little pictures below there are your friends that are talking about it. I'm not sure either.
My pictures are different than the pictures in, you know,
yeah,
Facebook pictures.
I mean, if you do it, do you recognize any of those faces? And then below that is kind of it updates in real time, right? So it'll show you what the world is talking about. Now, we tried less political phrases. We went with like social media. We couldn't get it to work. We even went with Tesla and we couldn't get it to work because that was trending in the news yesterday. So I don't think that this is fully rolled out, but I think that for all keywords, but I do think that for sure, you know, like you could try to take a trending topic on Facebook and search for it and see if it works. It would be interesting to see whether they expand this to include latest conversations on other topics. Now, I guess the one thing that comes to mind is how is this any different than what we see in posts, right? Because if you type in North Korea and you put posts in, I wonder whether it only is going to show you the high profile posts instead of all the posts. So it looks like this just kind of
it
almost feels like Twitter, doesn't it? You know, with what they're trying to do with the latest conversations.
Yeah. And it even says there that the topics are going to be the ones that are kind of the high profile topics, and not coincidentally, they tend to be the ones that are the most controversial, semi-political, the ones that get people fired up.
Got it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, there you go. Whether or not this has got a marketing play, I think depends on whether or not, you know, I mean, it just frankly depends. I don't know what to make of this feature, but let's move on to the next one. All right. This is kind of intriguing, Kim. If there's a way that you can plus up quite a bit so we can see that top graphic and kind of read some of the text that's inside of that graphic, that would be awesome. And I don't know if it's possible.
Is that enough?
No, keep going a little bit more. So brands using Facebook, that's good. Brands using Facebook lead ads and a Facebook lead ad. Why don't you describe what that is for folks, Kim? What is a lead ad?
A lead ad is an ad that you run and you are attempting to collect some information like a phone number or an email address so that you can start the conversation.
So Facebook is taking the concept of a lead ad and they're integrating what they're calling offline conversions into it. Now, this is going to require a little bit of explanation, but I'm going to read a little bit from Facebook and then I'm going to give you my interpretation. It says, with the offline conversion solution, Facebook says businesses can direct connections between ads and results. They can create campaigns based off offline success by targeting high-value customers from the prior month using custom audiences and lookalike audiences and excluding in-store purchasers to find new local prospects. They can also gain insights and build campaigns based on the actual transactions that happen, like in a store, and retargeting buyers in a certain category with the next product or service you'd like them to buy. MarketingLand says something very similar. And here's the deal. We kind of tried to wrap our brain around what this means. And this is integrating with CRM systems, customer relation systems. So basically what Facebook is doing is it's saying, if you're using Salesforce or whatever, you know, CRM system you're using, you can tie that data from transactions that happen in the store. So if I walked into, Macy's and I bought a t-shirt, that data goes into a database and they know who I am, right? Because they scan my credit card information and somehow my name gets in the system and all that other information, and they know where I bought that. So now that information means that I was in the store recently, and if they wanted to, they could tie that information somehow with a lead ad and allow me to do more creative campaigns. That's kind of my take on it. While you were listening to me, Kim, is there anything that, any thoughts that you have on this? I mean, obviously this is targeted towards larger businesses that have sophisticated systems, I think, that will tap into this.
No, I think that you got that right. If somebody saw the lead ad or they filled out a form, they can connect you by uploading or integrating with that point of sale, either the CRM or the point of sale system.
So if you look at this graphic, look at this graphic on the left, you've got your customer transactions, right? And it's hard to see, but it shows point of sale systems and CRM or customer relationship or some other kind of system.
Right.
And on the right, they've got your Facebook campaign audience. Mm-hmm. And then in the middle, they've got this thing called attributed transactions. So somehow they're taking the Facebook custom audiences that you already have, coupling it with the point of sale transactional stuff and bringing it together to allow you to do new things. So if you are in the business of having, you know, you have a local business and it's got a point of sale system that somehow is, you know, a big system that could be tapped into Facebook, you might be able to get innovative now with your ads.
Well, and I think they're saying that they're allowing you to take your offline transactions, upload that data and create custom audiences based on that. Like, instead of uploading an email database of people on your email list, you can upload this or integrate with your CRM or your point of sale system and take that data and create a custom audience, much like you would with your email list.
Yeah, you definitely want to investigate this a little bit, folks, because it is definitely a little bit beyond our understanding. But we wanted to bring this to you because this is brand new news. Let's keep moving along, Kim.
Okay. So this next one is called, These are
topics to
follow on Facebook. And what this is Facebook will present you with a variety of different topics that you can follow. And you've got topics like horror movies, theater, photography, and whatnot. And you can then choose to follow them. And if you do, and say you click on one of these topics like horror movies, you click on it and it's going to give you on the right side a long list of pages that have content related to that topic.
By the way, let's clarify, this is not a feature. This is seen in the wild. Okay.
So this, right. It's a very small test.
We don't know how it works. Kim is just speculating how she thinks it works, because we don't know. All we have is a screenshot. So, but the moral of the story is, it looks like, if I can interject for a second, Kim, it looks like all this stuff on the right are pages that cover horror movies. And it looks like these are sources that are kind of creating a topic to follow in the center. But I think what's more exciting is that it actually has followers. You know, this is like a page, but it's not a page, right? It's a topic. Do you remember when there used to be these things called community pages, you know, where, and they were different than pages? This is like people following a thing, not a company. You know, they're following a thing called horror movies. And in this case, there's 1,554 people following this topic. So like where it starts getting excited is how do you be one of the sources for one of these topics, right? Because then all of a sudden you could get some more exposure. But right now, this is not a function that anybody has. This is just something someone caught in the wild.
Well, it was caught in the wild, but Mark Zuckerberg has commented on it.
Oh, really?
It is something they're testing. Well, what he said about it is this thing that they're testing, the purpose of it is to let users experience or show a range of perspectives so that people can see where their views are on a spectrum and come to a conclusion based on what they think is right. So there's something called a filter bubble, and that is where you basically see only posts that agree with your viewpoint because your friends agree, and that's your filter. That's your filter bubble. You live within a bubble. And so they're experimenting. Yeah,
but that's not what this is about. This is about topics like photography and horror movies. You know what I mean?
Right. And this is his experiment with finding ways to burst that filter bubble, to slowly let you see things outside of your comfort zone, if you will. This is their experiment with allowing people to get outside of their bubble.
What's interesting about this is right now, the people that found this said there was only a couple of topics that you could follow.
Right. And they're not controversial at all because he doesn't want to blow people's minds. So they're non-controversial topics.
But what's interesting is let's start thinking like marketers here. What if you are following a topic like marketing and you are a company that publishes content? You're going to want to make sure somehow that you become a source, right? Because if a lot of people follow that topic and somehow that topic gets huge exposure in the newsfeed, because look at it, it looks like a carousel ad, doesn't it? So the real question is, what happens once you become a subscriber? You know, do you see those topics at the top of the newsfeed before you see everything else? I mean, these are the questions that I would like to get my brain around. Or is it just like any other page and it's just the topics are sourced and brought in, and if you see them, good luck. It's all about how it shows up in the newsfeed, because you know it is an interesting concept that this is automatron. You know, it's like an RSS right. feed really is what it is, that happens to be manually assembled and presented to people on certain stories and topics. So I don't know if it'll ever make it to the light of day, because you know, some of these things obviously are tests.
Right. And they said it's a very, very small test.
So, all right, cool. Do we have any more screen shares, or is that the last one?
Nope. We have another.
Cool. Can you plus that up a little bit?
Sure.
All right. So Google has added a cool thing called Nearby Event Search. And you guys can try this right now. Literally open your phone, pull up google.com on your web browser and type in concerts, or type in, whatever you want. And it will automatically show you a calendar that looks exactly like what you see right here. You're going to see all the concerts that are today, tomorrow, this weekend. And with the click of a button, you can go ahead and you can actually buy a ticket to those concerts. So here's some of the data that we have on this. Basically what Google has done is it has partnered up with Eventbrite, Meetup, and a number of other organizations like Ticketmaster, SeatGeek, VidSeats, Jambates, Live Nation, .. Yext, Eventful, you know, a whole ton of them actually. And they're kind of aggregating all of this together so that you can simply search for events. And I think that we were experimenting with this yesterday, weren't we, Kim?
Yeah, we were.
What were some of the things we could do with it? You can type in something specifically like, you can do a jazz festival, you can do concerts. I don't know what other you could. Oh, you could even do social media. We tried social media, and social media day, our local social media day thing came up first. So the key is your events will not show up unless they happen to be tied into these databases of Eventbrite, Ticketmaster, SeatGeek, Meetup, all that kind of stuff. So right now we don't know of a way to get your event listed outside of being involved in these things. Obviously, people don't think to search Facebook for this kind of stuff. You know, I would think they would naturally think to go ahead and maybe ask their friends on Facebook. You know, they don't think to search Google, I mean. So I think this is kind of a cool new feature, and you guys should try it. Like, and just see what events are actually going on in your neighborhood. And you don't have to say events in city. You could just say events and it kind of knows where you are. Yeah. You could put in concerts, find out concerts that are going on. I think it's pretty cool. And it's especially cool for anybody who actually does events. You know, more of a reason to possibly use some of these tools like Eventbrite, and just realize that you could do a free event in Eventbrite, and you could, and if people happen to be searching for it, it could be a powerful way for you to bring new traffic to your event. I think that's kind of cool.
It is.
All right, over to you, Kim.
Okay, so we've got Google has come out with a new Street View Ready certification standard with 20 new 360 degree cameras. So by the
20 new cameras, I don't understand what that means.
Well, what it is they've got a new certification standard, and there's 20 new cameras that are going to be ready with the certification standard.
Do you mean that you can go buy one of these 20 cameras and then take pictures and somehow get them up on Google? Is that what I hear you saying?
Correct. There's going to be 20 cameras by the end of the year that will meet these certification standards. And so all you'll have to do if you own one of these 20 cameras is download an app. You'll be able to use this camera and take pictures with it, and you can create your own street view for Google. And you can upload these pictures and have these gorgeous images for your Google local or maps.
Have you ever seen the Google van drive by with the cameras mounted on the top of it?
Yes. And in front of our house is actually a picture of my son looking like a homeless child. It's horrible.
I'm glad you said that, because folks, if you've gone into google.com and you just go ahead and search for your address and look at, especially if you own a business, look at what it captured and ask yourself, is this what you would want a customer to see if they happen to be wanting to come to my address and see what it looks like? Because it could be that it's a not very good shot. It could be that you had a big trash can out front. It could be all sorts of things. And this is what I think is exciting about this, is with one of these 360 degree cameras, you can technically override that, right? You can show a street view that looks much more appealing. Like, look at this farmer markets example, right?
They made it,
I probably would have gotten rid of the little, thing that's in front of the vegetables there.
Yeah.
But you can kind of, if you will. And by the way, someone who's entrepreneurial needs to go out to every local business in their community and say, I can do this service for you, right? I can make you look really good on Google Earth or Maps or whatever they call this thing. And I think this is a big deal, because I can tell you, when I travel to other cities and there is a thing that I'm thinking about going to as a tourist, I always look at the street view and I ask myself, is it as cool as they make it look? You know, and this is definitely, I think, a neat feature for businesses and marketers. Do you have any other thoughts on that at all, Kim?
Well, there were a couple. There's something that they said in the article that I wasn't aware of, and they said that this is expanding on their initiative for 2015 when they first introduced the ability to create your own street view images with their iOS and Android handsets. So I'm assuming that you've been able to do this for a while, just not in 360 view.
Interesting.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't aware of that. So that was interesting.
And realtors, hello, right? Think about the realtor applications here, right? If you can go ahead and create a killer 360 degree view of the house, you know, and people that are smart know that they can do that, then you can overwrite maybe the one that's already there from the street view perspective. I think that's our last screen share. Am I right? Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Let's see. I'll bring this back up. Is this one me? Let's see. Okay. Amazon rolls out something called Echo Show. Now, is this about as big as you can get it? Can you get a little bit bigger? Or no?
Let me give it a shot here. Is that better?
So, yeah, keep going. If you can make it a little bit bigger, that'd be cool. All right. So here's the deal. Perfect. See how those ads just magically disappear?
Yeah.
So Amazon has been revealing some weird things lately. If you guys remember, what feels like a couple weeks ago, they revealed one that had a camera in it, you know, which we thought was kind of weird and crazy and mostly meant to take pictures of kids' dresses and recommend clothes and stuff. But now they've got this brand new thing called the Echo Show. And the Echo Show is a Wi-Fi enabled home device with a 7-inch screen. It's like almost like the best way to describe it is like an iPad, a big iPad mini with a speaker on it. And it's Alexa powered. Some of you are thanking me for not saying the word. And basically the way it works is, here's what TechCrunch says. Previous versions of Echo have been all about asking questions and getting responses. This new device takes a more in real life turn. One of the main selling points is that you can use Echo to show and make video calls with other humans. That's one of the cool things you can do with it. But as we if we scroll down a little bit more, I think we've got some other screenshots, don't we, Kim? If you keep scrolling down the page, just scroll down the page. I'm pretty sure there's more shots on this article.
There we go.
Of some of the cool things that it can do. So, as you can see, it's bringing up a cool little display, like a reminder that you have dinner with Judy, and it's got some recommended words down below. You see where it says, first name, add this to my calendar, and, minimize this just a little bit, Kim, so we can catch, there you go. Now click on the next one in the bunch there. This is it as a baby monitor, and you notice the words down below, you can talk to it, and it says, Alexa, show me the nursery. So that's kind of cool. Go to the next one. Play. I can't read what's underneath
play,
the words.
View. Play the beats. Show.
Play the beats. Okay. Go to the next one. It looks like a YouTube clip. And then the last one, it looks like a phone call with picture in picture. So here's the deal. It's $229. So it's a lot cheaper than an iPad. But it's fixed device. It's, as far as I know, you plug it into a wall. It will be available June 28th. And some of my immediate reactions on it, you know, are like, seriously, do we need this when we have this in our phone, right? We can do all these things with our phone. It seems to me as if the Amazon ecosystem is trying to become what the Apple ecosystem is, right? So they're taking Alexa, and it seems like they're infusing the video functionalities into what frankly just appears to be a smart picture frame, right? It can do some basic features. And and by the way, on this, keep this up here. The other part of the news is that Amazon has added free voice calling to Echo speakers, but you can only call another Amazon product. You cannot call a phone. And that's part of the problem. It's like, so there's no reason to believe that this phone call is going to work unless someone happens to have this exact same device on the other end. And that begs the question, do you really want to run into the room where this thing is plugged into the wall in order to have a voice call? So I kind of feel like Amazon's missing the mark here. And maybe they're going after an older demographic that's not, you know, doesn't have a smartphone, or maybe doesn't realize that all of this functionality is available on a smartphone. But, you know, here you go. If you guys, you know, maybe have an Amazon person and they love it, this is the next product from Amazon. All right. Next, over to you, Kim.
Okay. So Instagram has launched an almost fully functional website for mobile. So before, users could only browse, like, follow, search, and see notifications on the mobile website and desktop site. And now users can share from the mobile web and have a limited explore tab. Well, that's rolling out now since March. So we've still got some missing features on the mobile web. And so you still can't upload video. You don't get filters. You don't get stories. And you don't get direct messaging. And you still cannot post from the desktop site. But you can share from the mobile web, post pictures from the mobile web, and you do have a limited explore tab. So
Kim, I'd like to clarify, because you kind of passed over a couple of things really quick here.
Sure.
Why is this important, and what do you mean by mobile web and desktop? Clarify the differences.
Mobile web is on your cell phone, going to Instagram.com. You can now upload pictures. And there's a limited explore tab. And this is important for people that live in mostly third world countries that don't have a lot of bandwidth, and they can't download the Instagram.
Or if you have a horrible internet connection and you right. still want to get on Instagram, right?
That's true. Yeah. And they've brought out other types of workarounds for people with bad internet connection, like the ability to do some things offline while you have a bad internet connection. And so they're you know, they've got some things they're working on, but this is primarily to bring in all that. You saw that they had that huge jump in user acquisition not too long ago, and they're really bringing in a lot of new Instagram users, and those are primarily from third world countries. Well, this is one of those initiatives that's helping that growth.
And what about the desktop? Because that's the big question everybody's asking. Does this bring the functionality, the full functionality of the app to the desktop?
No, you still can't upload pictures from the desktop. There's kind of a workaround you can do that CNET posted, but for the average user, it's not viable.
Yeah,
it's not a viable for the average user.
Okay, Periscope now allows Android users to broadcast in live 360 video. So if you're an Android user, Periscope has finally updated it. Its Android app to allow you to go live 360. Over to you, Kim.
Okay. Well, running short of time, so I'm just going to say that basically Facebook will now be focusing its efforts on investing in Oculus rather than in Oculus stories rather than creating its own virtual reality stories. So it's going to be
investing in stories. What does that mean?
It's no longer going to be creating its own virtual reality stories. It's going to be investing in other companies that create those stories. So,
and for those that don't know what a virtual reality story is, what do you mean? Were they making movies or something?
Yes, basically the stories that you go into in virtual reality, those worlds, those experiences, they're not going to be creating the experiences. They're going to be investing in the companies that create them.
Got it. A couple weeks ago, and maybe even a couple months ago, we talked about some of the cool stuff that you can do with Pinterest Lens, which is the ability to use Pinterest to kind of look at a picture and identify things in the picture. Well, they have a Pinterest Lens beta now that allows, it now can identify a lot more objects inside the picture. So if you haven't messed around with that, give that a shot. Over to you, Kim.
Okay. Well, YouTube has announced plans to launch new star-studded shows that are premiering exclusively on YouTube and will be fully ad-supported. And there's going to be 40 original shows, some of them like a sampling of some of the stars, Kevin Hart, Demi Lovato, Ryan Seacrest, Katy Perry, and they're going to be launching later this year. They're going to be free to watch, ad-supported, and one of the first sponsors will be Johnson & Johnson.
And this is not YouTube Red. This is regular YouTube. Yeah. So you don't have to have a subscription to this. And
exactly.
And this is YouTube coming out with their own quote unquote television content. And it'll be interesting to see if YouTube turns into Netflix as a result of this. And
yeah. I'm
surprised Facebook hasn't already kind of started some of this kind of stuff because, you know, we're seeing Twitter partnering with stuff. We're seeing YouTube do stuff. Very, very interesting times. All right, folks, listen, we have less than a minute left, so a couple of closing comments. First of all, if you're new to this show, get on our subscription by simply going to socialmediaexaminer.com/live show. Secondly, if you find value in this show, share it. Thirdly, thank you for coming, and thank you for being part of our show. We bring you the news, whether there's a lot of news or a little news, we bring it to you every single week, and we will be back with you next week. So with that, I hope you have a wonderful day. And we'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.